In the last video, I installed some under-gantry LED warning lights, prepared the wiring for a laser engraving module, and updated the Arduino bootloader to solve an unusual behavior with the D13 pin flickering on and off when the controller was reset. In this video, I'm going to install a pair of fans to aid air circulation within the enclosure, fit a 240V UK plug to the enclosure door, which can be activated by the spindle enable pin relay, and finally install and wire a variable frequency drive into a separate enclosure, which will power the router spindle. I start by wiping off the diagram of possible connections for an orange Pi board. I've decided that I'll make that up as a separate enclosure, so I have the option to still use my laptop. To start with, I fit the fans. I had to find 24V fans, which was a little trickier. I think in retrospect, I should have wired all the proximity sensors, LED lights and buttons to 12V DC, but I started with 24V, so I had to finish with it. The fan at the bottom of the enclosure pushes warm air out, and the fan at the top draws cool air in. The enclosure case I'm using is a little annoying as there's a seam along the centre, which makes it impossible to fit a larger fan. So I ended up using 40x40x20mm fans, which will have to run faster and therefore be noisier to move a similar amount of air as a large fan would. I also found dust covers for the fans, which will help protect the components inside. I soldered the fan wiring together and terminated those at the 24V DC power supply. When the power turns on, the fans start automatically.
Okay, I've just wired up the fans and I'm going to turn it on so you can hear how loud it sounds.
I also fitted the USB panel mount to the enclosure where I'll be able to connect my laptop or a dedicated external computer device to the control board. I 3D printed the yellow surround for the panel mount to make installing a little easier and tidier. I'm now fitting a 240V UK panel socket to the enclosure. This will receive its power via the no voltage release switch. I had to change over to the insulated blue female spade connectors, as I had crimped two sets of cables coming out from each terminal on the NVR switch, from which one pair of live and neutral goes to the EMI filter, while the other goes to the 240V panel socket, with the live going by the relay module controlled by the spindle-enabled terminal on the control board. When the machine is off or idle, the relay is in a normally open state, and no power can pass, but when energized, when the spindle-enabled pin is triggered by software, it receives power. I could use this socket with an extractor or a typical woodworking router. But for the purposes of this video, I use it to power a laser disco light while performing a test drawing sequence. I'll feature the drawing tool in an entirely separate video once the overall build is complete. I'm just going to drill a hole out for the cables which will go to the VFD. I still haven't decided whether to get another box like this and try and squeeze this one in, or possibly to get another box like this and buy a smaller VFD and know it will fit. This one's a little bit too big, so I may have to take the top panel off so it fits, or potentially turn this on its side. I'm now temporarily wiring the frequency drive to the controller. Later I will place the drive in a separate enclosure with a detachable power and signal cable from the main controller enclosure. I'm connecting the spindle enable from the controller via a relay on the output relay module to the X5 and digital common terminals on the frequency drive, and the 0 to 10 volt signal again in the same way to the AI1 and analog common terminals, which control the spindle speed. In my previous machine, I also connected the e-stop via another terminal which I had programmed to break the spindle and act as an emergency stop. But I couldn't find LED backlit buttons with dual terminal input, so I couldn't wire the hard and soft stop to a separate relay module and then onto the VFD.
Okay, I'm now going to place the VFD over here inside this other enclosure, and I'm going to make sure the panel is accessible from the outside, and I also have a toggle switch so I can go between the VFD potentiometer and the G-code PWM and the software. I'm just going to take this stuff apart. I've already taken a photo. I think I can get it in facing upwards if I take this top panel off.
I'm drilling the openings for the power to come out from the main enclosure, which will be connected to the VFD enclosure with a kettle lead end.
Just cut out this hole for a kettle mount, so the power coming from the main section of the controller ends in one of these. That gets plugged in, and then the power can then be fed to the frequency drive.
I may have to move the machine in future, and it would be difficult to do so if I can't dismantle it. I'm now laying out the VFD display panel on the door so it's clear from the electronics within. I'll just say here it's quite tricky to cut an ABS enclosure with a jigsaw because the cut line can remelt and close up. It's also very smelly, so a vapor mask is a good idea. That's where I realised I placed the VFD in the wrong position and couldn't lock the door. I'm drilling the opening for the toggle switch, and after I fit that, I place the ribbon cable to the display panel. You can buy ribbon cable and connectors fairly inexpensively, and all you need to do is use a good clamp or vise to push the connectors onto the ribbon where you need.
Okay, I've just done the wiring, just got a bit bored of filming, so just cut ahead.
I also had to reprogram the VFD, which I've written as an Excel document to show the settings I've changed. My frequency drive is an NF Lixin. There's not much documentation about this drive, so I had to do this from scratch with a poorly written manual and a lot of trial and error.
Okay, I've just taken the old CNC machine apart and placed a new one on the bench over here with the main body of the controller over here and the enclosure that will hold the VFD just next to it. I now need to just fit this wire in.
The last thing I had to do was wire the SY cable from the VFD to the spindle.
Okay, I'm going to have to place the hole a little bit to one side just because there's a bit of plastic buttress or something in there just to keep the shape and clip it together. And if I drill through that, it might weaken it, and also I may not be able to get the locking nut on.
The silver thing in the enclosure is a break and resistor for the frequency drive. They do a few different things, but the main thing is to de-accelerate the motor quickly. I can't quite remember if there was a difference between braking speed in the previous machine when the spindle enable signal turned off and if the e-stop terminal on the driver was triggered. But I didn't test this, so there's no point me talking about it. I made sure to loop the wire through some ferrite cores to help with frequency spikes, and that also went through the drag chain, which you're technically advised not to do, but I'm going to risk it because it looks neater. We also meant to fix exposed armour near the end of the cable to the back plate with a strap, which can help drain the EMI. I'm now testing the spindle using the toggle switch to manually control the spindle RPM with a potentiometer. In retrospect, I should have placed the LED lights onto a delay timer relay module. As you can see that while the spindle is powering down, the lights have already reverted from red to white. Something to remember for the next machine.
Okay, the one nice thing about these enclosures is I have these attachments that I can fit onto the back, something like that. And this is what I've ended up with. I've screwed them onto the wall, although in doing so I realised that, or re-realised that this corner over here is really damp, but thankfully these are IP rated, so this should be okay where it is for now. I can open these up and show you what they look like on the inside at the moment. So the electronics in here and the VFD over there, and at some point I'm going to have to think about ventilation for this enclosure, but I'll do that sometime in the future. I think passive ventilation should be okay in here. Notice that I can turn the spindle on and it can be on for a little while before the fan turns on this. And there's a function that you can go to on the display panel to actually let you know the temperature of the variable frequency drive itself. Last time I did it was only at 20 degrees. This room is actually quite a cool room, so it's nice having it up here because it means I can have a bit of space below it, either for my laptop, so I can work a little bit closer to the machine and actually see what I'm doing, or just use this as a general working area. I still need to make a dust shoe because the old dust shoe from the previous machine, which I've dismantled, doesn't actually fit on this, and I could probably change the bottom plate, but I think I'd rather try and redesign it from scratch and solve some of the problems with the older one.